Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Welcome to worship this morning. The Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Last Sunday, we celebrated the joy of receiving two infants into the church through dedication and baptism. And today, we say goodbye to a long-standing and stalwart member of this congregation, Joel Grayson IV. But we want to do so in a very positive and celebrative atmosphere, because we know that this life is only the beginning, and death is only a transition from this life into the everlasting life in the presence of God our Father. So all we can say to this is hallelujah and praise the Lord. What a good day it is to be in the Lord's house, to share as a family the joys and the sorrows, the triumphs and the tragedies of life. But we do so not just as individuals, but also as a family. And so, welcome to so many of you who have come back, who have come here especially to be with us today. We pray that it will be a day of celebration and a day of joy as we celebrate the life of Joel Grayson IV and his commitment to this congregation, and ultimately we give praise to God our Father. And in order to lighten it up just a little bit beforehand, I thought I was going to look nice today. And this suit that I'm wearing, the jacket, the pants, the shirt, the tie, the pocket square, the shoes, and the belt, just about everything but the undies, were provided for me by Joel Grayson just a few years ago. So I thought I would do that. And then I realized that the Joel Grayson IV Dressing Award today goes to Ed Brucker, because look at him. Because he could almost pass for Joel with that outfit on there. So, amen to that. We have one birthday this week. It is Peggy Denmark, I believe. Am I right? Do we have any other birthdays that I'm not aware of, or any birthdays among our first-timers or returning members here today? Any anniversaries? Okay, so let us sing happy birthday to Peggy Denmark. And moving on, let's go ahead to our announcements real quick. If you would, those of you who are on top, who are cool, would you take out your phones and go to Facebook and invite your friends to join us for worship today, as I will attempt to do now. You can see that I am just a little bit at the edge of middle age, where I'm trying to remember how to do this correctly. And sometimes it works, and sometimes I am just off the mark there. Okay, there we go. Thank you, everyone. Let's get on with our announcements really quickly here. We have all the usuals, of course, at the front end. We continue to support Networks Cooperative Ministry with non-perishable food items. And every week, either Bruce or Beth Sheffer come about Wednesday and pick up whatever we have brought in, plus whatever of the bread products that are left over from Publix, and carries them over to Networks. And so please continue to bring non-perishable food items, and we thank you for that. The next slide, math tutoring continues, and as the new school year is now in session, we probably all know some child somewhere who is just filled with all kinds of angst about math. And so we have a great math, quote, therapist who's able to calm them and help them to figure out how to work through these problems. So please tell them about math tutoring from 9:15 until 10:15 in the morning. Next, our Wednesday schedule is in full swing now, with the handbell players meeting at 6 p.m. and our Bible study going on in the fisherman classroom at 6 p.m., excuse me. And we are doing our survey of the Bible from Genesis through Revelation, and it's about understanding the relationship between how the Old Testament Hebrews and Israelites became the Jews and Christians that we know today. It's been a lot of fun so far, and I think you can drop in at any time, and you'll be just fine. And, of course, at 7 p.m., choir practice on now to the next slide, which is our September calendar. As you can see, there's a lot going on. Just to highlight a few things here quickly. On September the 5th, there will be the Women of Light meeting, which will be at Margaret Watkins' house. And Margaret is right here, if you raise your hand and see her or see one of the other ladies about that. I think you'll find it a very exciting and meaningful time of fellowship. On the 8th, we were starting a new adult Bible study class at 9:15, because we don't want to interfere with choir practice. But from 9:15 until 10:15, I believe it will be meeting in the library or in the fellowship classroom. It will be led by our elders, starting out with Tim Thompson, and they're going to start out with a series I'll show it's on another slide, but it has to do with things the Bible doesn't say, which I think would be very interesting to hear about. A few other things here. Tucker Community Singers is going to start up their new season in a couple of weeks. And other than that, the Disciples Women's Retreat you see there at the bottom, I think that time to sign up for that is rapidly coming to a close. We strongly encourage you ladies to consider going. It's going to be a great trip. And all the ladies who go just come back talking about how great it was. And so we really sort of feel jealous of them, don't we, guys? Okay. And moving on, here are your flyers. On the left, the adult Bible study that's going to start on September the 8th. Half-truths, things the Bible doesn't say. And then, of course, on the right, we're calling our Wednesday night program From Tent Dwellers to Tent Makers, How Ancient Hebrews Became Jews and Christians. And I encourage you to come to those as you see fit, but we strongly encourage you to consider them. Next slide. We are working to create a mission team, and the goal, of course, is to reach out to members of our community, as we have done in the past, but also to consider some possible short-term mission projects, like a trip to the Appalachians and help do some service project work. This church has a long tradition of doing Habitat for Humanity projects, and this is along that same line. And who knows, maybe God willing, in a few years, some of us will get on an airplane and travel to some other part of the world for a week or so and do some missions there, too. That would be awesome. So if you're interested in that, please see me or Marcia or someone else, because we'd like to talk about how we plan for the future through missions. All right. And the last thing is, of course, as always, we want to thank the person who brought us our goodies today. Who do I have to thank today? Gail, thank you very much, Gail. That's right, you're very busy today, aren't you? Bringing the goodies and worship leader and all this kind of stuff. So wonderful. Okay, with all that now behind us, let us prepare our hearts and our minds for this hour of worship and celebration.
Good morning and welcome to all, in person and online. Our service is always in praise of the Lord. Also, as Tom mentioned, we are celebrating a member of 86 years, Joel Grayson IV. From Ecclesiastes 3, 1 through 4. For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to break down and a time to build up. A time to weep and a time to laugh. From Matthew, also in Matthew, I lost my little note, but it's like, the verse deals with, you know, it's yes, you're mourning, but yes, you will be comforted. For all those who can rise, please join us in hymn 546, verses 1, 2, and 4.
Oh,
Amen. You may be seated. Dear family, friends, and loved ones, I greet you in the name of our Lord Jesus. I greet you in the name of this congregation, the First Christian Church of Atlanta. We are gathered here today both to worship our God and also to celebrate the life of our dear member, Joel Grayson IV. May God's presence be with each of us and bring comfort to all of our hearts. Let us pray. God of unfailing love, we are gathered here today as friends, family, and fellow members of Christ. We remember Joel Grayson, who departed from this world and entered into your presence. As we honor him, let the unconditional love that you showered upon him during his life fill this service. Help us to learn how to love others unconditionally with that same love, because we find comfort in the knowledge that Joel has now found rest in your arms. We seek your blessing upon this service today and upon all who are assembled in this place. Eternal God, our refuge and our strength, console and support those who are sorrowful through the comfort of your word, so we might be confident in this in every time of need, trusting in your love. Illumine us through your word, so that hearing your promises, we may find peace in your presence. Let your word be a lamp to our weary feet and a light unto our path. Enter our troubled hearts at this hour, that we might discover the promise of new life in your eternal presence. Heavenly Father, you have not made us for darkness and death, but for life with you forever. Without you, we have nothing to hope for, and with you, we have nothing to fear. Speak to us now your words of eternal life. Lift up our hearts from anxiety unto the light of your presence, and set the glory of your love before us through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And now, in this time of gathered worship, we appeal to you as many parts of the one body of Christ. Hear us as we each pray from the silence of our hearts. Gracious God, grant us the yoke of Christ, binding us together, tethered by your love, guided by your presence, bringing your kingdom into this world. It is for this kingdom that we now pray, using the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Would the deacons please come forward for the offering?
Thank you.
offering today serve you among all in all sorts of wonderful ways, and that our community is enriched by our outreach, and that many who have not fully opened themselves to you find you. Amen.
If you will trust in God to guide you and hope in God through all your ways, God will give you strength, whatever betide you, and bear you through the evil days. Who trusts in God's unchanging love builds on the rock that will not move. These uplifting words are from our hymnal, page 565. If you will trust in God to guide you. Our hymnal is filled with inspiring and loving words. And through singing these wonderful words, our faith becomes stronger. Our love gets deeper. Our painful wounds get healed, and we share the joy of Christian fellowship. Just like singing these wonderful words from the hymnal supports our faith, we experience the same whenever we participate in communion together. We experience peace like a river, joy like a fountain, and love like an ocean whenever we offer each other the bread and wine, just as our Christ offered to his disciples. And now for the words of institution. For I received the Lord from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that our Christ on the night he was handed over took bread, and after he had given thanks, broke it and said, this is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, also the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the death of the Lord until he comes. Let us pray.
As the bread at the Lord's table is broken and eaten, it is done as our Savior did. As we eat the bread, let us cherish his love. Let us attest to our faith in the Lord. Let us know the wholeness he brings to us. Indeed, let us be joyful in being at his table. It is our sacred covenant with the Lord.
As we partake of the blood of Christ through the sacrament, let us be reminded that the cross signifies not only that the past has been forgiven, but that the future is reborn from the resurrection of Christ. So as we take these sacraments, we do so in honor of the sacrifices made by Jesus to be an example in our life as we give unto others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Our scripture this Sunday is from John 14:1-3. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. The word of God for the people of God.
Temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
Thank you, Ed. It seems like every time he does that, I want to say that was the best. And anyway, at this time, I ask Buddy Queen to come forward. Do you have anything to share? I'm sorry. I have a few extra things to share. at this moment. Several people expressed their regrets that they could not be with us here today. Among them, the Atwood family, Herman and Bootsy and Cindy, regret that they could not be with us today in person, but they spent the night at the emergency room, and they do want us to know that everything is fine, everything's going to be okay, but obviously quite exhausted from that experience. Tim and Debbie Thompson wanted to be here today, but Tim is visiting with his mother, or I should say they are visiting with Tim's mother to do a little ministry unto her. But these are some comments that Tim asked me to share with the family. Tim says, Debbie and I have been attending First Christian Church of Atlanta since 2018. We joined the congregation in early 2019. We met many wonderful people, but I did not get a chance to really speak with Joel Grayson until a few weeks later at a gathering in Moy Hall. I learned that Joel was very opinionated. Yeah, I'm expecting the laughter because that's true, right? Yeah, okay. That was okay because I am too. And if you know Tim, you know he's very opinionated. As the Lord would have it, our opinions rarely aligned. This started ongoing, lighthearted discussions about almost anything. I will miss you, Joel. Your legacy is cherished. Tim Thompson, Elder. Also, our custodian, Dennis Bryan, wanted to be here today, but because he serves in the Army Reserves, he has maneuvers this weekend, so he sent these comments to you. To the Grayson family, our deepest condolences to you and extended family on the passing of Joel. At this difficult time, we pray that God will grant you the peace that you need to get through this. A person that departs from this earth never truly leaves without leaving a testimony, as they are still alive in our hearts and minds, and through us, they live on. Dennis and Ordena Bryan. How well do you know the man is a question that kept repeating itself in preparation for this message. And it is a good question for us to begin with today. Joel Grayson IV always presented himself as a well-groomed, well-dressed, and well-spoken man. He was the kind of man you imagine, at least I imagined, puts on a button-up shirt and a pair of slacks before he goes down to breakfast. And yet he also has a kind of an easygoing Jed Clampett air about him. And I thought I would give you exhibits A and B. This is probably why I always joked with Joel about his house having a cement pond. Joel had a smooth voice, a voice for radio, you might say. He spoke often, and he often sang whenever we could hear him, sometimes in fun activities. He always had an eloquence about him. He also had a temper. You didn't see it often, but it was there. Having served time in the U.S. Navy and being true to the stereotype, Joel occasionally demonstrated his mastery of the sailor's vocabulary. In ways that were not always obvious, Joel Grayson was a man of contrasts. Joel spent his entire life in this church, in this congregation. You know, therefore, his age and the number of years of membership are exactly the same, 86. Now, if we do a little math, we learn something interesting. If you look at the year that this church, this congregation was established, and I know there are contradictory dates. Some say 1848, some say 1851, some say 1853. We're going to do the logical thing and take the middle one, 1851. I think that's a very safe bet, right? If our congregation was founded in 1851, then this year, 2024, makes our congregation's current age 173 years old. And if you divide 173 years by 2, you arrive at 86.5 years, which is almost exactly Joel's age. Which means, of course, that Joel Grayson IV has lived through half of the life of this congregation. His birthday, I believe, was on July the 18th, and he passed away about 3 weeks later. But if you think about it, Joel's life coincides with practically half of the life of this congregation. I think the word legacy is very appropriate here. Joel was not only a lifetime member of this congregation, but he was a fourth-generation disciple. Which, I'm just being a little bit scientific here and doing some calculating, but that means if he's a fourth-generation disciple, that means that Joel Grayson I and Joel Grayson II and then Joel Grayson III, whom some of you knew, and of course Joel Grayson IV, were all disciples of Christ. Joel IV was also a member of what is called the 50s group. And that has nothing to do with age, at least not now and not when they started, but somewhere in the middle, I guess it did. What is the 50s group? Well, the 50s group is basically the youth group of the First Christian Church of Atlanta during the 1950s. And this group not only shared and treasured their formative years in church, going to camps, going to retreats, and probably causing trouble on the Prior Street building and in the Briarcliff building. I've heard stories about Joel and John Brodman running through walls and having to repair them. Bootsy told me that one, I think. And their parents took them down to Prior Street and made them repair it themselves. This 50s group not only shared these formative years, but they have maintained close contact over the decades unto this very day. The 50s group is now yet a little bit smaller now that Joel has passed on. But all of them, like Joel, are very faithful to this memory, to this friendship that they started 70-some-odd years ago, and many of them are still lifetime members of this congregation. Like Joel, they are also a big part of the legacy of First Christian Church of Atlanta. As many of you know, Joel served this congregation in many capacities, including as an elder, a trustee, personnel chair, nominating chair, etc. And like Frank Sinatra, he did things his way. And you can laugh because nobody's surprised by that statement. He always had a very clear idea of what he wanted to do and how he wanted to do it. And it always seemed to me that even when I disagreed with him about something, it was always a gentleman's disagreement with Joel. I think the thing I will remember the most about Joel, and I suspect this is true of most of you as well, is, of course, his humor. Joel was, without question, a wit and a comic. He might use the word smartass to describe it, but, you're shocked that I said smartass in church, but I'm just being Joel for a minute. That's what he was. His humor was fun but edgy. I called upon him and Elliot Denmark on several occasions to entertain us during a talent show. We called it the Worship Talent Show. We also had several cornbread jamborees. And other such things. He and Elliot would take turns amusing us with their anecdotes, sometimes individually and sometimes playing off of each other as a comedy team. And we would all be laughing until tears rolled down our cheeks and we had to wipe them away and say, I'm not crying. But like I said, his humor could be edgy, and every once in a while I thought to myself, I wish he hadn't said that. Joel was funny and he did things his way. Joel was funny and affable. But in some ways, he was a man of few words. He said what he meant, and he meant what he said. And I suspect that he would want me to do the same in speaking at his celebration of life service. I asked him several times while visiting with him in the hospital or talking to him on the phone about this very service. What kind of hymns, what kind of scriptures, what kind of things would you like to share? And he never gave me an answer. He just kind of sidestepped it and changed the subject or moved on. But in contrast to this, I asked Joel how things would be, how are things in terms of Claudette and Karen and so forth after he's gone. And he told me in his usual matter-of-fact way that he had absolutely no worries at all. Joel had seen to it that they would be taken care of. Everything was covered, and he trusted the people that he put in place to be with them. And as you probably know, if you were to describe Joel in a nutshell, you could say detail-oriented, planning ahead, but spiritually kind of private. It takes all kinds of people to make a church healthy and successful. And Joel did a lot for us, as he did for Karen and Claudette and Buddy and for others, to ensure a reliable future beyond his lifetime. The branch of the Grayson name ends with Joel Grayson IV, as he had no son of his own to carry on that name. But this Grayson name, which has been a part of the DNA of the First Christian Church of Atlanta for 173 years, is immortalized in our history. Joel IV's lifespan includes at least three locations, at least, I know for sure, Briarcliff, and here, La Vista Road. And so I think it is safe to say that even when we are all gone, the contributions of the Grayson family from Joel I through Joel IV, their wives, their children, and so on, will always be a part of the legacy and the DNA of the First Christian Church of Atlanta. Even if they are not remembered, their legacy is still intact. Because what is done cannot be undone. It is safely stored away in the vault of history and remains forever. In this service today, we hold Joel Grayson IV in grateful memory, though he is now separated from us bodily by death. He is never separated from us in spirit. He is still here in many, many ways. While in the body, he was closer to us, but now he is fully with God. And though we cannot bring him back to this earthly life, we honor his memory in our hearts and celebrate the fullness of his 86 years of life with all of his strengths, foibles, goodness, and weaknesses. As we conclude our service today, we will continue to honor Joel in the following ways. We will sing our closing hymn, verses 1 and 4 of Abide With Me. We will have a benediction, and then we have still one more thing. So I ask if you would, please join me now as we sing verses 1 and 4 of Abide With Me. going to ask Captain Don Sherrill to come forward, and as he does, I would like to pronounce the benediction, and afterwards he will have a few comments on the Navy hymn, and then the choir will sing the Navy hymn in honor of Joel Grayson IV and his service to our country. Take courage, go in the knowledge that the loving God is your eternal friend and companion. And may the God of peace, who brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, make you complete in everything good, so that you may do God's will, working in you that which is pleasing in God's sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Eternal Father, strong to save, whose arm hath bound the restless wave, who bids the mighty ocean deep its own appointed limits keep. Oh, hear us when we cry to thee for those who peril on the sea. Carry on, Joel. May you enjoy fair winds and following seas.
Thank you.